to take us into the year 2067. We have a lineup this afternoon. We'll share the plan with you, and also we have a number of guest panelists who will offer observations on the plan, and we'll have an opportunity for feedback from you as well. I want to thank everyone for coming. I want to thank as well those who may be watching via a webcast, and I'll make sure that everyone is aware that we have simultaneous translation available. So if you're would prefer to operate in another language, most of today's discussion was going to be in English. If you would prefer a translation, just see the translation booth at the back. We would encourage you to post on social media. The address is hashtag capital, C-A-P-I-T-A-L, 2067. Hashtag capital 2067. I'm going to get things started by inviting Chief Brian Francis to come up and to offer an Aboriginal welcome and blessing on today's events. Brian.
Thank you, Alan. Good evening, everyone. I begin, as is the Mi'kmaq custom, to offer a warm and friendly welcome to those who are visiting our territory, as well as to those fortunate enough to call it home. On behalf of the Mi'kmaq governments, the Mi'kmaq Confederacy of PEI, and all Mi'kmaq citizens of Ebiquit, I say Jalasi, which is welcome in Mi'kmaq. For time immemorial, the Mi'kmaq have been gracious hosts to those living, to those visiting the land of Ebiquit. It is my great honor to stand before you this evening, tracing the footsteps of my ancestors, and to extend the hand of welcome and friendship. I look forward to an informed and lively discussion over the next couple of hours, discussing the important role of our national capital region as our country grows, thrives, and evolves to meet the challenges of an exciting future. While we live in the greatest country in the world, we must be mindful that is far from perfect. Success depends on the lens through which it is viewed. For many, Confederation has been such a success, but for the indigenous population, including the Mi'kmaq, who inhabited this island for over 12,000 years, Confederation and colonialism have had tragic consequences. However, there is hope that we can actually build upon all the positives that Canada has to offer and create not just the best country in the world, but one in which we all benefit and prosper. I stand here as the elected chief of a Mi'kmaq nation, addressing a national meeting and participating in an important discussion about the National Capital's Commission's plans for an inclusive and meaningful national capital in the next 50 years. This would not have happened 100 years ago, or 10 years ago, or probably even 5 years ago. I share that thought for two reasons. One, to highlight the incredible strides we have made as a country. And two, to remind all participants this evening not to be bound by the unknown or to be limited in our thinking. We must be expansive, we must be visionaries. The true beauty of Canada is knowing this, that our future generations will gather, as we are this evening, to look back in awe with the distance we have come and with the admiration for those who have helped get us there. I look forward to this evening's forum. Thank you. Walalio.
Thank you, Chief Francis. I'm going to call on the CEO of the National Capital Commission, Dr. Mark Christensen, to present Brian with a small gift in token of our appreciation. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Christensen, who will be more appropriately introduced later on, as will Chief Brian Francis, who's going to be one of our panelists as well. The event tonight is called Canada's Capital and You, a Continuing Conversation, and it is indeed a continuing conversation. Back in 2011, the Canada's National Capital Commission began a conversation with Canadians about the next number of years and what that would hold for Canada's capital region. It is extremely important, of course, that our nation reflect not only our heritage, but also our aspirations as a nation. The plan that was developed as a result of consultations across the country is going to be presented tonight by Dr. Christensen. It was developed in consultation with a whole host of Canadians, including people here in this city back in 2011, as well as with professional planners and others from right across the country. Dr. Christensen will be presenting not only the three main themes of the plan, but also will be touching on the 17 key initiatives that have been identified within the plan for fulfillment over the next 50 years. And while these are final, both in terms of the themes and in terms of the 17 key initiatives, while they are final, the way in which they're implemented and the various steps and conditions involved in those is not final, and that is part of the process in moving across the country. And by the way, we are the first city to be invited to provide feedback on the national plan as well. But before we begin this evening, I would like to call on the Honorable Robert Mitchell, the Minister of Communities, Land, and Environment for the province, to step forward and to bring greetings from the province of Prince Edward Island. Minister Mitchell.
Thank you very much, Alan, Mayor Lee, Chief Francis, Dr. Christensen, other esteemed guests and board members that are with us here this evening. Well, good evening to everyone, and I am absolutely delighted to be here with you all this evening, representing and on behalf of the province of Prince Edward Island. The capital, with its rich history and bright future, is a source of pride to all Canadians. As we look ahead to the next 50 years, we are given the wonderful opportunity to help guide its evolution. As with any plan, partnership and collaboration is very important. Thousands of Canadians joined in public discussion to share their vision to make this plan the best it possibly can be. Now it's an exciting time as we move forward, making that plan a reality. Of course, the best way to move forward with this plan is to continue to engage those from all across Canada. The world is changing quickly, and we need to be adaptable to these changing demographics. Planning ahead and making proactive decisions on how we adapt to these new realities is key. The central themes of the plan are three that we also focus on here locally in PEI. Inclusive and meaningful, ensuring that everyone feels welcome and at home, whether they are just arriving or have lived in Canada for many years. It is important to celebrate our diversity and embrace change, while at the same time honoring our history. Picturesque and natural, the capital offers many beautiful natural areas, from parks to green spaces to waterways. These spaces not only have high ecological value, but are near and dear to the hearts of many. As urban areas continue to grow, it is more important than ever to keep these spaces healthy and sustainable. Thriving and connected, staying in touch, and listening to the needs of local residents keeps an area thriving, current, and successful well into the future. And no one knows an area better than those that live and work there each and every day. Staying in touch with residents who have an inside view of what is working, as well as the day-to-day challenges, is vital. It is an exciting time as we celebrate the nation's 150th year, celebrating our pasts and embracing our future. As we celebrate 150 years, we have taken a look back at our experiences, successes, and challenges. Looking back helps us plan for the future. And we aim to create a capital and a nation that everyone will continue to be proud to call home. I look forward to following the implementation of this 50-year plan and the many exciting projects that will accompany it. And I want to recognize all organizers and participants of this forum and extend a warm welcome to all those who have traveled here from outside PEI. Thank you very much for being here, and I do hope everybody enjoys this evening. Thank you very much.
Don't take my notes.
Thank you very much, Minister Mitchell. I want to acknowledge the presence of several of the board members of the National Capital Commission. One of the reasons why Prince Edward Island was first, or Prince Edward Island was the first port of call on this nationwide tour, is the influence of Prince Edward Island's representative on the National Capital Commission, Basil Stewart, who is well known to everyone. Basil, perhaps you'd stand. And joining Basil here at today's event are his colleagues, the representatives from New Brunswick and Nova Scotia as well, Carol Lowry from New Brunswick, and Lisa McDonald from Nova Scotia. Now, I want to call on His Worship Mayor Clifford Lee to come forward as well. Of course, Mayor Lee is no stranger to anyone in this room. He has been the perennial mayor here in Charlottetown. I think dating back, he's been a member of council since 1988 and has been re-elected mayor on four different occasions, I believe. To bring greetings from our capital city to the capital city of Canada, Mayor Clifford Lee.
Thank you very much, Alan, and I should let everybody know Alan is my campaign manager for the next election. Minister Mitchell, Dr. Christensen, board members, staff of the National Capital Commission, ladies and gentlemen, it's a real pleasure for me to be here this evening to bring greetings on behalf of the city of Charlottetown. I can talk about the importance of the city of Ottawa as our nation's capital to all of us as Canadians. Anytime we visit Ottawa, you always get a sense of pride. You always get a sense of this is what it means to be Canadian. And I don't think it's because of the Ottawa City Capitol, and Mayor Watson's not here, so I can say that. But I think it's because of the tremendous work that the National Capital Commission does in the Ottawa-Gatineau area. And certainly, Doctor, to you, your board member and staff, you are to be commended and congratulated on creating our nation's capital that we all, as Canadians, can be very proud of. And a lot of my other notes, Minister Mitchell took my notes earlier this evening and read them and opted, obviously, to use my notes for his speech. So, Mr. Minister, thank you for that. But seriously, I do want to very quickly welcome you to Charlottetown once again. It's great to have you with us here all week. We had a great session on Monday evening past, to talk about the first pillar, the inclusive and meaningful capital. And I have to admit, I was sitting there tonight looking at your three different themes. And I think it's reflective of most municipalities in this country, what we all strive to achieve, the inclusive and meaningful community, a picturesque and natural community, and a thriving and connected city. It's also relevant to what makes a community great. So we had a great talk on Monday evening past, and that again, we're honored that Charlottetown has been chosen as one of the four cities across the country that you're going to be visiting. And I think it's very appropriate that Charlottetown was the first city you've visited, because it was back here in 1864 where the Fathers of Confederation first met to talk about this great country of ours. And it's equally important and appropriate that we're meeting here at the Confederation Center of the Arts, the monument that was built to recognize and honor the Fathers of Confederation. And Jesse, to you and your staff, thank you for making tonight this facility available for us for tonight. So again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Welcome to Charlottetown, and I certainly look forward to tonight's discussion.
Thank you very much, Mayor Lee. Partnering with the National Capital Commission in this exercise of sharing the vision for the next 50 years for our National Capital Region is the Royal Canadian Geographical Society, and we're pleased today to have the CEO of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society with us. John Geiger is the CEO of the RCGS. He is an internationally best-selling author. He's best known for his book, The Third Man Factor, Surviving the Impossible, and four other books of nonfiction, including Frozen in Time, The Fate of the Franklin Exhibition, which describes the result of the Franklin Exhibition forensic project. Mr. Geiger is an editorial board member of the Globe and Mail and a senior fellow at Massey College, and before assuming the CEO role of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society, he was a governor and vice president and president of the society as well. So please welcome John Geiger.
Thank you very much. Hello, bonjour, and thank you for your kind introduction. It's a pleasure to be here with you in Charlottetown, this historic capital city that has played such an important role in the birth of our country, representing the Royal Canadian Geographical Society and celebrating our partnership with the National Capital Commission. When our society was established nearly 90 years ago, it was the hope of our founding fellows, our own founding fathers, including the Honorable A.E. Arsenault and the Honorable John Alexander Matheson, of course, both of whom served as premiers of this province, Sir Charles Dalton, the Lieutenant Governor of this province, and MP Chester McClure and Joseph O'Sullivan, Bishop of Charlottetown. So all sorts of very important figures in our early days were from PEI. And it was their view that the view of all these founders, that the RCGS, through the RCGS, Canadians would have an opportunity to better appreciate and understand our country's unparalleled geography. With such an important and ambitious mission, we have been fortunate to build lasting and important relationships with organizations that share not only our passion for this country's geography, but our vision for the future, a vision where Canadians feel themselves deeply connected to the land, wildlife, people, and places that make up our great nation. And through this connection, are better prepared to help chart Canada's future. The National Capital Commission is one such organization. I'm tremendously proud to be standing here today together with our partner, Dr. Mark Christmanson, and the important board members of the NCC, to invite all of you to take a closer look at the NCC's plan for Canada's capital region. Since 2011, the RCGS has been a partner in this project and actively involved in the vast and extensive consultation process that led to the creation of this plan. As a result of this consultation, we have worked with the NCC to develop and showcase an incredible interactive exhibit on the future of Canada's capital. This exhibit has, for the summer, been housed in Canada's Geography and Exploration Pavilion, which also happens to be the new home of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. It's been seen by more than 10,000 people already, and the exhibit has brought Canadians from across the country together to experience how their national capital region will grow over the next half century to proudly embody the values of inclusiveness, togetherness, and respect for our environment. Further, with the publication of the book, The Plan for Canada's Capital, 2016 to 2067, the RCGS has been proud to contribute to the creation of a beautiful resource to help visualize our capital's growth in the years leading up to Canada's bicentennial. As the NCC moves forward with this national tour, engaging with Canadians from every part of the country, inspiring spirited civic discussion on what comes next for our nation's capital region, the RCGS will be proud to stand with them as partners. In doing so, I know that we will not only be helping to make Canada better known to Canadians, but also to show that through a shared experience of our capital, we can come together with optimism to envision the future of our country and ourselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. It's now my great pleasure to introduce the Chief Executive Officer of the National Capital Commission, Dr. Mark Christensen. Dr. Christensen was born in Prince Rupert, but he tells me that he considers himself a New Brunswicker, having grown up primarily in Fredericton. He has been an employee of the National Capital Commission since 2004, when he began work as the Director of Capital Events, and he was appointed as the CEO of National Capital Commission in 2014. He is the author of a number of scholarly articles and also the book Plateaus of Freedom, which is largely based on his PhD dissertation from the University of Concordia, where he completed a PhD in humanities. Please welcome to Prince Edward Island, Dr. Mark Christensen.
Thank you, Alan.
To build an inspiring capital that is a source of pride for all Canadians.
Good. Thank you, Alan. Minister Mitchell, Chief Francis, fellow members of the board of the National Capital Commission, John Geiger, thank you for coming. I don't know if we have fellows of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society here tonight. Are there any fellows? Yes, there are some in the audience. That's great. Also, Jesse Inman, thank you for hosting us in this beautiful, beautiful room. Distinguished guests, mesdames et messieurs, good evening, bonsoir, kwe kakina. I'd like to thank the City of Charlottetown and our great friends at the Geographical Society for making tonight's forum possible. Et merci à vous tous de votre accueil chaleureux à Charlottetown. Thank you so much for your warm welcome over the past couple of days. It's been educational, but also a lot of fun. It really is a pleasure that in this 150th anniversary of Canada's Confederation that we can be here with you in the place where it all began. And I hope that in turn that some of you may have made it to the Ottawa Gatineau and Canada's capital region during the 150th celebrations. It's not too late. There are a few months left in the year, and I'll encourage you to come and visit Ottawa Gatineau, and we'll encourage everyone there to make it to Charlottetown before the year's end. This building really resonates with the 150th, with the centennial, its architecture that is so distinctive of Canada's centennial, and also its artistic mission that parallels so closely the National Arts Centre that it's set in the heart of Canada's capital, right across the street from the NCC's home on Confederation Square. This center is also a legacy of 1967, the flagship of the Centennial Halls, and it marks a long-term project for the arts and culture of Canada that I think has come to take a great place in that legacy. The Prime Minister of the day, Lester Beer Pearson, referred to this project of an arts and culture for Canada as those intangible but precious things that give meaning to a society and help create from it a civilization and a culture. And it is in that spirit that the NCC pursues its role as the steward of federal lands and buildings of the capital, and especially as its long-term planner of taking the long-term view of the development of Canada's capital. So it's a great pleasure to be here for this evening of conversation about its future, of the role Canadians can play in it. As has been said before, like Canadians from coast to coast to coast, have already played a significant role. Over 20,000 people have participated in creating the plan. And while its broad strokes are in place, the three pillars that have been mentioned and 17 milestone ideas for the next 50 years, its implementation now rests on the creativity and ingenuity we can draw on as a nation. For example, one of the milestone ideas on which the plan is built is developing the capital's shorelines into a world-class recreational and cultural destination. La capitale est située au confluent de trois grandes rivières dans la rivière des Outaouais, surnommée l'autoroute transcanadienne d'origine et du canal Rideau. Les cours d'eau comptent donc parmi ses attraits les plus caractéristiques. Waterfronts are going to be the future of Canada's capital, and so in Charlottetown, you have an iconic waterfront and still in the making. I've spent the past couple of days in fascinating conversations with the mayor and so many people, some of you here tonight, about developing waterfronts and about other elements in the plan that I think are consistent with what you're trying to do here in Charlottetown. Meeting with Lieutenant Governor Lewis. We also had a tour of the Flotilla Festival yesterday. Kudos to co-curator Becky Vow for fostering this very innovative project, and also to the City of Charlottetown for helping these artists use your public lands in an exciting new way. So it's already been an education over the past few days, and we look forward to hearing more tonight. But maybe before I continue, I'll just take a minute to talk about the National Capital Commission, because not everyone is familiar with what we do. I've said that we're the planner and steward of federal lands in Canada's capital, and this mandate reaches back to 1898, more than a century to the Prime Minister Sir Wilfrid Laurier. Ces terrains et ces actifs sont considérables et comprennent nombre de lieux patrimoniaux importants du Canada, des institutions culturelles nationales, de même que le parc de la Gatineau, qui se classe au second rang des parcs plus visités au Canada. We have 500 square kilometers of territory, 1,700 properties, about 700 rental or leased properties, many of them great heritage value, the six official residences of Canada, two interprovincial bridges, about 100 other bridges. We're like a municipality in some ways in the scope of the 13 urban parks, the Gatineau Park and the Greenbelt. So as the largest landholder and asset holder in the capital, I think we have a role to play. And part of the plan has been to think, how do we use this asset base in the best interest of all Canadians? The NCC is governed by a board comprised of dedicated and talented people from across the capital region, but across the country, a total of 15 people. Three of our members you've been introduced to here tonight, and thank you all for coming, and particularly thank you, Basil, for spearheading this initiative to bring us here. We also have some of our staff here, and I'm not going to introduce everyone, but people from our planning staff are here, and also from our outreach staff. The legislation of the NCC that guides us is really, I think, continues to be very elegant, although it was framed back in the late 1950s, and it is to prepare plans for and assist in the development, conservation, and improvement of the National Capital Region in order that the nature and character of the seat of the Government of Canada may be in accordance with its national significance. So the nature and culture of the seat of government should be in accordance with its national significance. Cela va bien au-delà de la protection et de la conservation de notre patrimoine bâti et de la volonté d'agir de bons intendants de notre patrimoine naturel au nom de tous les Canadiens, même si ces choses sont d'une importance cruciale. This vocation of building a capital that is symbolically significant, that reflects the national character and aspirations, must be a source of pride and inspiration for Canadians from every corner of the land. And our goal is to have a capital in which all Canadians see a reflection of themselves and where everyone feels included and at home. And the plan we're discussing tonight is designed to realize this aspiration, but it's the latest iteration of a project that began more than a century ago, as I mentioned, with the Ottawa Improvement Commission founded in 1898. There were three great planners in the 20th century who built the planning legacy of the NCC. The first here is Frederick Todd, who is came out of Olmsted's office that designed Central Park and many, many other things. He was a very ingenious planner. Following him was Edward Bennett, who designed Chicago, among other things. And after that, Jacques Grébert, the great French planner brought by Mackenzie King after the 1937 World's Fair to plan the capital. Comme ces urbanistes qui ont abordé les grands enjeux de leur époque, ce plan traite des besoins et des aspirations d'une capitale du 21e siècle. And if I had to say one difference between the three great master plans of the 20th century and what we're proposing here tonight, is that this was really truly a people's plan. It doesn't come from a master planner. It comes from a citizen-focused consensus-building process that's involved tens of thousands of Canadians from across the country, and which started, in fact, right here. Now, it all culminated with an online survey where we asked Canadians what should be the 17 milestone ideas that carry us from 2017, the sesquicentennial, to 2067, the bicentennial. And it built on this conversation that had evolved these three pillars, and we're so excited with all the ideas that came in. I'm going to introduce our panelists as I go along here, and we'll bring them up in a few moments. And we've organized this around the three themes. Inclusive and meaningful is really the first time in the capital's planning history that we have a master plan that dedicates itself to inclusivity. And we mean social inclusivity, cultural inclusivity, economic inclusivity, and also the inclusion of people with disabilities. It's a plan that invites all Canadians and of all regions and of all backgrounds to come to their capital, to feel part of it, and to be part of building it. This is going to mean creating new symbols that reflect our diverse society, as well as honoring sacred symbols received from the past. It's very important that we note that Canada's capital is situated on the traditional lands of the Algonquin Anishinaabe Nation, and that this is a fundamental aspect of how we should define inclusion through all the things that we do in this plan. I started with the words kwe kakina, and this is the expression of welcome in the Algonquin language. Selon comprendre et reconnaître de façon réelle, concrète et importante la présence autochtone et de traditions culturelles vénérables dans la capitale. And maybe I'll just take a moment to point out this wonderful hanging sculpture here that was created, as you know, by the youth, Indigenous youth of Canada, and what a great symbol to focus our discussion. So I would like in turn to recognize that we are here today on traditional Mi'kmaq territory, and I hope that this will inform our discussion tonight and some of the comments that Chief Francis will make in a few minutes. Our second pillar is picturesque and natural, and all the three 20th century planners that I mentioned sought to accentuate the capital's picturesque setting. But the plan we're presenting now presents a new special emphasis on environmental sustainability. We've kept that somewhat antique word, picturesque, very intentionally, but natural brings in the massive challenges we will now face with environment as a capital, as a country, climate change, increased urbanization, invasive species. And we also wanted to foster new thinking about the increasing value of our precious green spaces. We've started to work on a concept called natural capital, which is really an economic modeling that includes environmental costs in stewardship and policy making. And I'm very pleased that Catherine Hennessy is here tonight to share some of her experiences, especially with regard to preserving built heritage and public spaces. Finally, the third pillar, thriving and connected, is about building a capital that's active and competitive in the international stage. a center of dynamic opportunity and prosperity that takes an active role in a deeply interconnected global community. This really came out of discussions with the business community, particularly their emphasis on being such a great asset holder, we should play a role in the economic sustainability of the capital. Some of the ideas under this are to present an illumination strategy for the capital. And here you'll see the board of directors just approved this master plan for capital illumination. I believe it's really the first of its kind in Canada and even in North America outside Old Montreal and Old Quebec. So we're very, very proud of this. But it captures some of the spirit that we're trying to get in the thriving and connected and innovative smart city, culturally exciting, economically sustainable, and highly desirable to top talent as a place to live and work and raise a family. C'est un lieu où la mobilité et l'accès universel accru permettent tous résidents et visiteurs de participer pleinement à la vie de la capitale de leur pays. You can imagine in many ways these pillars overlap, and it will be an intersection of these themes of inclusivity, sustainability, and connectivity. We've talked about the waterfronts and your role, your I think success in animating your shoreline and waterfronts. And this is a plan. This is a priority for the plan. And I'm pleased that Alex Forbes has joined us tonight to share his thinking on this important subject. So I think with that, I'm going to move on, thanking again John for coming and for our board members and for all the people who've joined us tonight. I'll just close with an idea what would make success for this plan. I think the plan would be successful if it becomes the basis for greater collaboration. A great plan is open to elaboration and extrapolation, and I believe this is what Canadians themselves have achieved. So I look forward to launching this conversation here tonight. I thank you all very much, and in the Algonquin language, I will finish Megwich. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Christensen. As Dr. Christensen pointed out, there are three themes within the plan. Ensuring a national capital region that's inclusive and meaningful, one that's picturesque and natural, one that is thriving and connected. We have four panelists with us tonight. The panelists are going to address each of those themes. In the first instance, Chief Brian Francis, and I'll invite Brian to come up to the stage now, and you can stay up here as well, Dr. Christensen. We have Catherine Hennessy to speak about picturesque and natural. Catherine, would you come up? And I might point out that Catherine is the birthday girl today. And to speak on the theme thriving and connected, we have Doug Keefe. And I invite Doug to come up to the stage as well. And to give us a local focus and to talk particularly about that theme that Dr. Christensen identified very early on, the important work that the city of Charlottetown has done in beautifying and in restoring its waterfront. We have from the city of Charlottetown, Alex Forbes. Each of these will be introduced more appropriately later on. It's so encouraging to see Dr. Christensen's presentation and to know that the next 50 years for our national capital are already being planned. Every time I go to Ottawa and look at our beautiful Parliament buildings and all of the other government buildings, I thank God for the prescience and farsightedness of those planners, particularly those three important planners that Dr. Christensen spoke of, and thank heavens that they had the foresight and the presence of mind to plan ahead and to build given the great disregard that politicians enjoy these days, if we were to build a parliament building, it would probably be an ATCO trailer. But thank heavens we have the beautiful buildings that we do have in Ottawa. I'm going to call now on Chief Brian Francis to come forward and allow me to more generously introduce Brian. Brian was born and raised in Lennox Island, Prince Edward Island. He received his early education in Lennox Island and in Summerside. He completed 4 years of apprenticeship training, became a journeyman carpentry, and was the first Aboriginal person in PEI to receive his Interprovincial Red Seal certificate. In 1983, he accepted the position as education coordinator with the Abigwit First Nations, and he went to work with the federal government in 1988 and spent almost 20 years there in various positions with the federal government before becoming the chief in 2007. And Chief Brian Francis says that among his proudest accomplishments is the signing of the Canada PEI Mi'kmaq Partnership Agreement. Please welcome to speak on the theme of inclusion and meaningfulness. Please welcome Chief Brian Francis.
Thank you, Alan. Good evening again. When I became chief in 2007, one of my priorities was to work better to promote the Mi'kmaq language, heritage, and culture, not only with the PEI population, but also within our own Mi'kmaq communities. I felt that our communities were losing touch with their language and their history, and that is the recipe for losing one's culture in the long term. I knew most of our population wanted to change that, and we went about tackling that issue head on. Part of the procedure to reconnect with our history, to reclaim our language and our identity, meant partnering with federal, provincial, and municipal governments, as well as many other stakeholders, to ensure that our Mi'kmaq culture was on display, was integrated throughout our province, through our towns, villages, and cities, and also that these stakeholders and institutions took the necessary steps to not only welcome our population, but to create spaces where they could be comfortable, welcomed, and supported. One of the great examples of this is the Maui-Omi Center at the University of Prince Edward Island here in Charlottetown. This initiative was started under Premier Wade McLaughlin back when he was president of UPEI. The initiative has expanded and continued under President Aziz. The Maui-Omi Center is a space on campus where our Aboriginal students can feel at home, where they can share their proud customs and heritage with students from all cultures. It's a place to gather, study, fraternize, and relax. The Mi'kmaq governments have also just recently finalized our plans to construct a new building on the historic Charlottetown waterfront. A critical element of the building will be a cultural center where the off-reserve Indigenous population can gather. Another feature will be proper space for expanded and enhanced programs and services for the Indigenous community. Space for the Indigenous community by the Indigenous community. This design will not only address a need for space, but it will also create culturally relevant space. It will indeed be meaningful and inclusive. As we move forward, we will continue to look for opportunities in the provincial capital, which provides both practical and cultural recognition and inclusivity. And this very principle has direct application to the national capital region. Canadians from all walks of life want to see themselves within sights and attractions of the region. They need to know that they are welcomed not only with words, but with gestures of meaningful inclusion. For the National Capital Region to be our home, we need to reflect the realities of all members of our diverse family. Thank you very much for taking the time. Walalio.
Thank you very much, Chief Francis. The second theme of the National Capital Commission's plan for the next 50 years talks about a National Capital Region that is both picturesque and natural. And we have, to speak to that theme, one of Charlottetown's, not one of, the Charlottetown's certainly best-known heritage activist in Catherine Hennessy. Catherine has been working to preserve and protect the city's and indeed the province's historical distinctiveness for many years. She's recognized for her passion for Charlottetown's history and her work in preserving valuable documents, records, public spaces, and buildings. Catherine, as many of you know, was instrumental in the establishment of the PEI Heritage Foundation in 1973, and she served as the foundation's first executive director. She has received many awards, including an honorary doctorate degree from UPEI, the Lieutenant Governor's Medal from Heritage Canada in 1988, and is a member of, since 2001, a member of the Order of Canada. Please welcome, in the midst of her birthday celebration and in the midst of closing out her house and moving, but you'll be happy to know, moving within the city of Charlottetown, please welcome the well-known Catherine Hennessy.
That the fact that I'm standing on two legs is just an amazing feat today, to tell the truth. I just wanted to say that 28 years ago, this year, the National Capital Commission came to town to help us run a charrette on Great George Street. And I was looking at with Aileen Merriam, because you guys don't know your history very well, because I was trying to think of that woman's name, and none of you knew. Anyway, it was on Great George Street. And the recommendations, I'll just read a couple of them to you. The solution, that a solution be sought to deal with the tourist automobile and bus traffic, that no parking be considered at all on the street, especially in front of Province House, except for ceremonial functions and major church functions. We haven't done anything about that exactly. That the former Queen Square school site be acquired by the government and a building architecturally sympathetic to its surroundings be constructed, and that its use would complement the focus of the street. I mean, this brings tears to my eyes, that all wiring be put underground. We've done some of that. That historic plaques will be informative and interpretation carefully designed, and then we've done that. That the church bells, that the basilica be installed again, either in the tower or in some carefully designed structure in the vicinity. Wow, we did that this year. Check that off. Anyway, yeah, Aileen Merriam was a great inspiration to us. And we kept a good friendship going. So I just wanted to say that the National Capital Commission was here 28 years ago. It is no accident that we have these capital cities to love, protect, and work with. For us, it goes back a long term time. In the 1760s, the Board of Trade and Plantation appointed Samuel Holland to survey the eastern coast of North America from the north of the Potomac, and he began his survey here on the island. He laid out the island into 67 lots, three counties, and declared a site for the capital here where we are standing tonight. What a location. In 1768, Charles Morris from Halifax laid out the town into 14 water lots, 500 town lots with five town squares, 35 12-acre lots in the Common north of Houston Street and over 500 12-acre lots in the Royalty. We were presented with the bones that we're working with today. Our attributes are many: building stock, parks and recreational facilities, golf course, racetrack, rinks, and swimming pools. We are enriched with our educational institutions, our healthcare facilities, and our strong cultural life. It is hard to imagine that the city, without the Confederation Center of the Arts that we are here today, it would be hard to appreciate that. What a gift to us. We have worked hard on beautification almost since the beginning, celebrating Arbor Day since 1884 and planting hundreds of trees. Who is the customer for all of this? We are the Charlottetonians first and foremost are the customers. Then, as the capital city, all Islanders. As the capital city, now new residents with their social and cultural mix, and of course our visitors. But I am a firm believer that we look at it for ourselves first, and not for the for tourists only. As caretakers, we must build pride and loyalty and raise our self-esteem. That will lead to improved property values, better returns on investment, and will create jobs and increase population, all very important. We have been busy, with the help of many hands, to build a support for their guidelines that we have directed, We certainly have a stack of studies that should be reviewed now and then. But here is a quote that I'd like to end with. Monuments with civic betterment seldom get anywhere without active and responsible leadership. Remember that, Your Worship. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Catherine. The third principal theme of the NCC's plan for the future is building a national capital region that is thriving and connected. And to speak to that aspect, we have invited Doug Keefe. One of the things that I've been impressed with by this young millennial generation is how entrepreneurial they are, and reading Doug's bio reminds me of that. Doug is the interim CEO of the Startup Zone, the early stage business incubator for PEI, which is down in Queen Street. He's a passionate supporter of entrepreneurship and building companies that have a strong focus on understanding customer needs. Prior to this position, he was the founder of Logical Technology, Inc. He was a senior project manager for Shared Services Canada, where he oversaw the management of a portfolio of key IT-based projects. Doug was also the co-founder and the chief technology officer of the Charlottetown-based startup Get Gifted, Inc. that that quickly grew to over 20,000 users and delivered millions of dollars and free gifts to its users. Please welcome, to speak to the theme of thriving and connected, please welcome Doug Keefe. Doug.
Okay, thanks, Al. So the word thriving, whenever I heard that, I was really excited when I was presented, you know, the opportunity to share tonight. And really, it's an important concept, you know, that embodies an energy that comes to a city, that the city projects. You know, it shows in itself the prosperity of commerce and meaningful engagement in cultural endeavors as well. So with a focus on building a thriving city, we bring people together, we share ideas, and continually improve on the idea of what makes a city great. And really, that aligns a lot with what we do at the Startup Zone whenever we're helping companies. So really, our goal is to help entrepreneurs that have high growth potential, and we want to help them compete on a global stage right here from PEI. So we do that in a few ways in terms of giving them entrepreneurial guidance and access to a lot of resources that will lead them towards success. We also facilitate lots of introductions to help grow their networks as well. Another thing we do is provide events. So in just over a year, we've had over 150 events that have brought together the entrepreneurial community here on PEI, sharing the stories of entrepreneurs, both new and more established ones as well. And as part of this role at Startup Zone, I've had the opportunity to work with new entrepreneurs really every week. So one of the very common things that we see amongst these new business owners that they're often very focused on their product, their service, or the technology that they're developing. And really our number one goal with working with these companies is to shift their focus away from what their product is that they're selling. And like we said, it's that deep understanding of the customer's needs, even before they're developing something to sell. So it's such a critical skill, and it's really transferable whenever we're thinking about building a thriving capital, whether that be building a thriving economy, the culture and policies. They all really start with people and really having a deep understanding of their needs. So I've also had the chance to work on some policy innovation work where we've actually taken this similar framework and applied it to the engagement process with citizens. And it's ended up with deeper and more meaningful way to engage with the citizens. And we've done that before even a line of policy was written. And the feedback we've got from citizens in those sessions were that they felt that they were met where they were at, as opposed to trying to understand deep policy type of terminology, and really getting a better understanding of where they want to go. And so we really always encourage people to never stop understanding who you're serving. And, you know, with Catherine mentioning that who are your customers, you know, that really is applicable. You might not use the word customer in every situation, but really understanding the people. And that's really what's core to what we're all about. So it's really, like I said, an essential skill, especially today in a rapidly changing business landscape. So in order to stay thriving, we just want to encourage people to always have an evolving understanding of who it is you're serving. So like I mentioned, we opened just a little over a year ago. We have become an important hub for entrepreneurship here in Charlottetown and in the province, province-wide as well. And unlike many incubators that you may have run across the country and really across the world, a lot of them have a tech-specific focus, where we've made the decision not to focus on technology, but to broaden it out to really any type of sector. What that has led us to is companies that are in the tech space, for example, like a automated aircraft logbook system, but also supporting companies in the arts and culture and event management type of space. So given, though, that we're not sector-focused, we have a unique opportunity to create collisions, what I'm calling them. And, you know, those are really opportunities that might not have otherwise happened if we focused just on one specific sector. So when thinking about connectivity, I think about it in terms of connecting people. So really, we often find it easy to connect with people with similar ideas or similar backgrounds. But, you know, sometimes the real magic really happens whenever you're coming together with diverse backgrounds and diverse perspectives as well. So with the type of environment that we've been able to put together, we definitely see that occurring with new partnerships, projects, and businesses really coming from the environment that we've created here. Really, so I'm always amazed at the creativity and ideas that I see from new entrepreneurs every week. Really, it's exciting, and it's really reinforced to me the fact that entrepreneurship really is alive well here on PEI, and you know, there's places like the Startup Zone here that are making a difference in supporting the entrepreneurs in those critical first stages of their business. So, all right. Thanks. Okay.
Thank you very much, Doug. Our final panelist is with the city of the planning department of the city of Charlottetown. The other day I was on Facebook, and Earl McDonald from Earl's Photography Restoration posted a video of the waterfront of Charlottetown in the 1960s, and I had forgotten what kind of an industrial slag heap our waterfront was. There were all kinds of ugly and abandoned old trains, buildings that were dilapidated, old warehouses that were falling down. There were tanks for gas and oil, and it was largely unattractive. And even though we don't have ability yet to scratch and sniff on videos, I could almost smell that putrid smell that always came from the Hillsborough River at low tide. Thankfully, we've moved on from that, and largely it's because of the farsightedness of our city fathers, who were mothers and fathers, who planned well in advance, and other partners as well, including CADC, who have played a major role in the redevelopment of the city's waterfront. And largely it's been led by people like Alex Forbes. Alec was born and raised in the Summerside area, and worked for 16 years with the city of Fredericton. He holds a master's degree in urban planning and business administration, has extensive experience in development control, long-range planning, policy development, and heritage preservation. After spending a long period of time, as I said, 16 years with the city of Fredericton, we were able to repatriate Alex in 2013, and he joined the city of Charlottetown to manage their planning and heritage department. And we're very pleased to have him to speak about the Capital Commission's 50-year plan from a local perspective, and perhaps to give some hints as to how they might tackle their waterfront issues. Please welcome Alex Forbes.
Thank you, Alan. So again, I've been asked to speak about the waterfront and our shoreline, and again, in some regards, how it connects to some of the themes. This opening slide, I think, really sort of hits the nail on the head in regard to thriving and connected. You've got the cruise ships there that are replaced activities that were formerly down there, industrial activities. We've got the world at our doorstep. They're coming to Charlottetown because they realize that there's something here for them. It's the heritage, it's the quaintness, it's all of the elements that have gotten achieved over a long period of time. I'm going to go backwards a little bit. What you're seeing there is a culmination of 250 years of work. I mean, we kind of take it for granted that it's been there a long time. It hasn't been there a long time, it's relatively recent, but again, if you look into that picture, you can see the green space, that's for the citizens. You can see the marina for the citizens as well. But again, the terminal is bringing economic activity in, the Delta Hotel economic activity. So it's that exchange that is working really well for us now, but it wasn't always that way. Again, this is about the halfway period in regard to the waterfront. This is about the turn of the century. It's the end of Great George Street, but again, you can see that isn't what we just saw on the previous slide. It's what it was intended to be. It was a working industrial area, commercial area. That's where most of the product came into to PEI and was dispersed through there. And again, Catherine touched on this, but the reality is, Samuel Holland picked this for the site for the city of Charlottetown. He had other surveyors prepare the plan, but that plan is critical in regard to the first 150 or 200 years. That plan provided the order that we need in regard to containing things, because if you didn't have a plan, that those industrial areas would have bled into the residential areas. That's the legacy that we have. We've been working with that for a long time. It's pretty well intact. And again, I mean, it is the great legacy that we had till it brought us up to some modern planning. The other thing, too, is the way that the waterfront evolved, it was the mixing of land uses. I mean, contrary to popular belief, planners don't like to divide land uses. Planners like to include land uses. And because of the way that the downtown evolved, downtown Charlottetown is unique in the regard to you can have a lovely home, you can have a business. There's a really nice mixture, and it came from that early template. Again, people formerly in downtown Charlottetown, they lived in the 500 lot area because they had to walk to work. You didn't take a taxi, so you wanted to live nearby. And what I find interesting is in 1921, 11,000 people lived in the what's regarded as the 500 lot plan south of Houston Street. Then in 2006, there was only 5,000 people. So there's a reason for that. There was out-migration, but now there's great demand for those people to come back. Again, sort of around the halfway period, you can see how active of harbor front that was. It was the age of sail. You can see how busy it was. All of those little finger wharfs were there to, again, bring in goods and services. Things were doing well. Prominent families made fortunes down there, built houses down there. And again, it was things were going very well for us. That whole industrial period pretty well extended up till the 1970s, and things started to go into decline for all kinds of reasons. The economy's changing all over the world very quickly, but for us, signs of that came in the 1970s, and a lot of those traditional industrial businesses started to fail. The products were not being brought into the province the same way. The 18-wheelers were bringing in materials. The trains were not as critical, nor what was the shipping. So again, the waterfront kind of fell into decline, but so did the downtown, the residential part of the downtown, because that's the period of out-migration. People wanted to get out of the downtown. They wanted to get into the suburbs. So this is another legacy. There's two real big legacies. There's the Samuel Holland and the subsequent plan for the 500 lot. But this was a plan that was done in 1973. And, as a planner, we kind of forget. I've worked on some recent plans, but this particular plan is really the genesis of what you're seeing in that first slide. And again, they did a great job in regard to looking at the city, not only the residential portion, but they also looked at the waterfront, and they have a great line in that report. It says, "The waterfront area contains the greatest mixture of land uses and activities in the urban area and provides a direct interface with the elements most influential in the history and development of the Charlottetown area," and that's the sea. So there had been sort of a separation. People in the first 200 years were not as inclined to want to get down into the waterfront because it was industrial. It wasn't that attractive. Again, the water quality wasn't great. But that Stevenson-Kellogg plan, all of those uses, they all have appeared. They're either down there, they were there, and they may have discontinued. But I talked to a developer today who's working on a project that involves one of those uses. So the legacy that we have from that plan, the Stevenson-Kellogg plan, is from 30, 40 years ago. We have newer plans, but it's all in there. The improved signage, the pedestrian network through that to bring the public into it, the marina to get people down to enjoy the waterfront. So again, that was the catalyst for change. There's a lot of things happened. People certainly started, the area started to transform, and then we were looking at tourists at that time, and there were some legacies that came out of that, Peaks Quay, the Delta Hotel, Harborside, which I live in. But that plan at that time didn't address the urban character. And again, I mean, it's kind of easy to forget, but that's kind of reflective. That's Water Street, some of the urban blight, that type of image was all over Canada as the residents moved out of the downtown. They moved to quieter and newer subdivisions. And again, through some proper planning, streetscape upgrades, a lot of things, that's what we were able to achieve. Again, Alan talked about when he was younger, and that was his recollection of downtown Charlottetown. All of that is there now has certainly been transformed, and it took a lot of energy for people to work to get those elements out of there, to work with the oil companies, to Alcoa, to clean up those lands. Those things take a lot of time and energy. And again, that's what it was transformed into, and the former industrial lands are then again on that issue of thriving and connected. It's to bring people into that area to enjoy it and to not have it as sort of a specialized land use that no one wants to be close to. Prior to me coming here, there was a waterfront master plan, and again, it looked at what needed to happen. Again, it tweaked that original plan. It talked about a number of things that should propel us for the next 20 or 25 years, and recognized that we still have a working port. It developed strong connections to downtown trails, balanced density and height, and it created the potential for a lot more residential development down there on the waterfront. The issues came out at that time that the waterfront is too valuable to compromise. So there was a lot of discussion if they wanted the right development down there, and they just didn't want to allow anything to be in there. They recognized the shoreline ecology, because that's one of the themes here this evening, and incorporate sea level rise and prevailing wind into that plan. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but this is the kind of tweaking that planners do. They look at all of those elements in very small detail. It was to connect the residential area to the waterfront, get some public lands in the waterfront, give people reason to go down there, and provided all of the detail. But where we are right now is to protect the waterfront from climate change. So after we spent 250 years building this waterfront area, there's still areas for potential down there, but we certainly don't want to lose it. So the issue when you're dealing with climate change, you're either dealing with mitigation or adaptation. Mitigation deals with reducing greenhouse gases. That's a much harder thing to do, but we can adapt. And in the Charlottetown Area Development Corporation, I see Ron here tonight, they commissioned a study called the Cold Water Report, and it looked at this issue in detail, and it provided a blueprint for how we should adapt to the changing environment that we live in and how we can protect it. It mentioned a lot of things like floating breakwaters, conventional breakwaters, wave fences, seawalls, dikes, and infilling. And it provided a number of options as to how we could proceed, again, to improve our boardwalks there. And if we're improving the boardwalks, we can also use that for protection. But this is a lengthy and costly undertaking, and it's going to involve all levels of government, private sector. Everybody has to be a part of that discussion, and we can work that into new plans when people come forward and want to develop on the waterfront. And we already have some of those measures in the plan. In the plan, if you want to build on the waterfront, and it's defined where you need to do that, but you need to get up to an elevation of 3.76 meters. And again, Alan alluded to it. In addition to the built environment, the city's invested recently into a municipal sewage separation project to improve the water quality so that people can recreate on the water. Again, give them reason for being down there. So that's a positive improvement. And again, this is just a picture of this is some of the detailed work that's come out of some of the scientists and the Cold Water Report and others, indicating it's at the elevations you need to build at. So that yellow elevation is pretty well right at sea level, and as you move back and where the color disappears, you're at that 3.76 meters. So we do have provisions in our official plan to work with developers who want to be down there. So in closing, the lessons learned are you have to work with what you have. We had a great plan. The original 500-lot plan served us well for a long time. You need to seek public input to make sure that the public are in sync with what you want to do in their community, as well as the businesses who are down there on the waterfront. You need to be patient because these plans do not happen overnight. And again, that plan from 73 is just really kind of manifesting itself in its totality now. So I guess in closing, I'd just say we spent the first 250 years building it. There's lots of opportunity to continue to build down there. But I think what we'll be doing for the next 100 years is trying to protect what we already have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex. I think Alex's presentation in particular underscores the importance of planning for the future. One of the things that I do as a kind of a sideline, from time to time I'll do walking tours for tourists who come in on our cruise ships. And again, it's one of these things that I thank daily the prescience and foresight of the original planners from, well, the late 1800s. Was it Newsom or Newcomb who laid out the five public squares in the city, including the square that we're sitting on, which was intended to be not only a square for the government buildings, but also for a market and such, and also our four green spaces. It was so important that that space was preserved and set aside for non-development, and we're all able to enjoy it now. I want to thank each of the presenters for touching on to the themes of the NCC's plan, and I want to perhaps engage them a bit in discussion. And one of the things that struck me, and I'm going to ask perhaps Dr. Christensen to comment on this, one of the things that struck me in these presentations was the fact that our capital city and our capital region is not inside a snow dome. You know, it's not one of those little Christmas ornaments that remain the same all the time. It's a living and active and thriving city, and it has to incorporate business and commerce and industry. And I guess the question would be, how does the plan make allowance for that?
Okay, good question. Well, I think the first thing I've learned tonight is we need to widen the Rideau Canal to bring the cruise ships in. I think that's the. I'm going to talk to Parks Canada about that. That question is, it touches, let's start at the governance level. Minister Joly, our Minister of Canadian Heritage, asked us to look at how we could bring the mayors of Ottawa and Gatineau on our board, and we came back with a proposal and discussion with the board members that was accepted, and we now have, really for the first time in 60 years, the mayors of the two amalgamated large municipalities sitting in on our board meetings. And this has been, I think, a great step forward. Canadians love complex governance structures, and so to have us all in the same room and at the same table, I think, is one thing. Because the municipality, if you think of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, the famous, and you have your basic needs at the bottom and the more aspirational and identitary needs at the top, municipalities really have to fulfill the bottom of that pyramid. That's really a big responsibility for them. And we come in somewhere closer to the top about symbolism and identity and so forth. So to have us working in collaboration with municipalities, not getting in their hair, and likewise them allowing us to add that value, I think is very important. I've had discussions with Mayor Lee where he doesn't have to contend with all these different forces. But in a way, you are a capital city, so you have to do all of that. You have to provide the fundamental services for safety, security, water, health, you know, so forth, and then but also make it a capital city. And it seems as though the planning has really paid off in the city of Charlottetown. And I really caught that phrase of, you know, taking 250 years to get it where it is, and now figuring out how to protect it for the next 100 years. We experienced terrific floods this spring, nothing like nothing we've seen in generations. probably related to climate change. And all of our lands on the waterfronts, of course, are the ones where we're going to have the same resiliency questions that you're going to have to face as a city. The focus of this plan was really aspirational in terms of what Canadians wanted to see, and it was interesting they didn't come back with ring roads or eliminating whole quartiers of the city and mowing them down. There were the great planning themes or great avenues, and there's no Champs-Élysées proposed. They really focused on aspirational things and sometimes quite abstract things. One of the ideas, I mentioned it at the lunch yesterday with the at the Lieutenant Governor's residence, is the idea of a having some kind of symbol for the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. People rated that very high, or they proposed this idea, and it's a very abstract idea that they want to come to the Capitol and be able to experience that somewhere other than just looking at the Supreme Court. And I thought that spoke to the inclusive and meaningful pillar. And if you could realize some kind of placemaking exercise that did that, it would satisfy that need. So the plan's very oriented to those kinds of visions. And the 17 ideas, starting with the renewal of the parliamentary precinct, I think really reflect Canadians' ideas of the importance of the symbols and how to knit them together.
Well, thank you, Dr. Christensen. Is there any other the panelists would like to comment? One of the questions that I had is probably for Doug. I've been, as many people have, I've read the some of the work of Dr. Richard Florida and his comments about the creative class and the importance of creativity within cities and the importance of that entrepreneurial class within a city. Have you read some of his stuff and taken a look at that, Doug?
Oh, no. I guess specifically, no. No, I haven't. Would there be a short thesis?
Well, certainly in your work, you're finding that that today's business in particular is probably well suited to a livable city. It's not heavy industry. Doesn't require a lot of our natural resources. It doesn't pollute our waterways or our air. And I think that while that's a characteristic of Charlottetown, it's also a characteristic of Ottawa. They're largely administrative cities and rely on...
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and you know, it is something that, with the use of technology, we can operate create businesses really from anywhere. The nature of that work is really changing too, so... the use of office space can look different now as well. I know that one of the general partners at the investment fund that's operated out of Startup Zone, he measures the success of an entrepreneurial community based on the hipster to laptop ratio at coffee shops. So and and so really, you know, the nature of that work is changing. You know, and that's and that's one of those little
fan
metrics.
That certainly fits with Dr. Florida's thesis, because you know, one of the things that he measured was the number of coffee shops and Starbucks in a city and measuring their creativity.
Maybe I can respond quickly to that. I mean, Dr. Florida was part of our opening event, actually. When we first started the consultations, he was one of the keynote speakers. And the idea that urban regeneration is led by the creative class, I think, has become an axiom now in studies of urbanism. But I recently had the head of one of our largest tech companies come to see me. And they're worth an awful lot of money right now. And he said, I thought we were going to talk maybe about sponsoring something. And he said, no, this is not a philanthropic meeting. He said, I'm here for business. And I said, okay. And he said, I've just hired the top algorithm writer from Netflix to move to Ottawa to work for us. And he's sitting in San Francisco saying, why am I moving to Ottawa to work for them? And he said, I need you to help me answer that question. You have to make this more attractive for top-level talent to want to live here. And I was thinking, listening to Doug, how Charlottetown could check off almost probably two-thirds of the checklist of what these kind of workers want in terms of lifestyle and in terms of things. And I thought it was very interesting to have a non-tech-specific approach to the entrepreneurs and startups and so forth, because I think there's a lot of room for that. And I think if you can blend the two, it's really, really quite interesting. But one of the other elements in that conversation is it came really clear to me that these newer, larger startups in the tech sector, a lot of these workers want to work in the urban center. They don't actually want to work in tech parks or industrial parks outside. And having such a great, vibrant, interesting center in Charlottetown ought to be a good attractor, as we hope we can do with Ottawa and Gatineau.
Well, one of the things that we're, I think we can celebrate in Charlottetown in particular is the fact that, you know, we punch well above our weight class in terms of arts and culture and fine dining and that kind of thing. And, you know, we're a city of 35, 36,000 people, but we also have 1.2 million visitors on average, or 1 million visitors a year. So that means that we cater to a much larger audience than our core community. Alex, in your presentation, you touched on the implications of climate change and what that's going to mean for the city of Charlottetown. And I know that you've done some planning in that regard, and I'd like you to comment on that, and then perhaps ask Dr. Christensen to comment the extent to which your 50-year plan makes mitigative efforts for climate change as well. So,
I guess I'm on. So, the issue with you got to realize. Planners, our job isn't to necessarily come up with these solutions, but we have to work with everybody to work on these problems when they're known. So that cold water report was prepared by somebody that was, they're scientists, and they tell us what needs to be done, and then what we'll have to do is then we'll have to work with the community, council, all levels of government, because it's not a case of at the municipal level, we can't write a policy necessarily that's going to deal with all of the different changes that need to be dealt with. So, again, it's more planning involved in that. It's more discussion. But the key thing is, we don't get a project on the waterfront every year. But what we want to do is, in the municipal plan, be prepared that if a project is down there, that we've integrated those considerations for that one particular project. And it's going to be sort of over the years, every time a private property needs an upgrade, they'll likely have to contribute in some capacity, not only to protecting themselves, but also if they're raising the elevation in front of their property, we may be able to get a trail over it. So it's protecting themselves. It's providing more opportunities for the residents to enjoy it. But we're just at a point now that these reports are relatively new, and that's going to be the challenge of not only myself, but a lot of other planners in regard to how do we make sure that it is protected.
Thanks, Alex. Dr. Christensen, I know you're not dealing with tidal water in the same way that we are, but nonetheless, I'm sure, given what's happening around the world and what we're seeing happening with the weather patterns over the last number of years, that this is part of your consideration as well in the planning.
It is, and surprisingly similar, and many, many cities are dealing with this. For us, it's not the ocean, of course, it's rivers and a huge watershed for the Ottawa River particularly, but also Gatineau River and the Rideau River that contribute to water volumes that we saw this spring that we've never seen. It was a whole neighborhood of Gatineau went underwater this spring, and they're still trying to recover from that. We've never seen this before, but in Washington, we work closely with the Planning Commission there, and it surprised me a few years ago when I asked them what their top worry was, and it is also flooding, and they've done extensive mitigation measures, including dikes and closing doors, that even the National Mall in Washington's vulnerable. Tomorrow, we're having a ceremony in Ottawa to twin the Potomac with the Ottawa River, and in fact, in a way twinning it mostly for environmental preservation reasons, but really this question of resiliency keeps growing and growing, and I think all of us with waterfronts have that. The one thing I would say is that when Sir Wilfrid Laurier in 1898 had this vision to acquire all of the waterfront lands in the capital into the public realm, and it took over 100 years to achieve it. We actually just did an acquisition this year that finally achieved it. What it really did is it brought all of the waterfront lands into green space. And so all of the structures, there were many, many dwellings and in industries on those lands were all gradually removed and it was green. And in a way, that is making resiliency because when it floods, it's easier to replace a pathway than a whole neighborhood or a whole industry. And we're learning to build pathways that to withstand floods. That's what we're learning to do. I would think that if we were working on the plan now, we would probably have put resiliency more at the forefront, actually, than we did after experiencing the floods this year. It was a real wake-up call of how serious those can be. So I'm sure you're taking that very seriously as well, and it sounds like Doug's got a good handle on mitigation measures and how you can use your planning to steer the built form of the city to raise it and make it drain and make it recover better after an incident.
Again, these things all underline and underscore the importance of planning. And even although we initially look and think that 50 years is a long time out, it's amazing how quickly that time can go by and so many things can happen in that period. It's absolutely essential that we lay out those essential plans, those initial plans, like the plan to acquire all of that green space. How important that is to us now that they had the presence of mind and the foresight to do that kind of thing. I'd like to invite any questions for panel members or for Dr. Christensen. If you'd like to tweak out details about the plans, I'd like to open up the microphones to the public, anybody that wants to come forward. I think we have one live mic here in the middle, and you can direct your questions to anyone at the front except me. Because I really don't know anything, but I would—we'd love to have your questions. Yes.
Hi. I guess my question would be around. Well, first of all, statement: I love Ottawa. If I had a choice, I'd live there, except for the temperature. So when I would think of climate change, I would not be worried. I mean, I would be worried about the water. But I would also be really worried about the temperature and the humidity in that area. And I'm wondering if that's one of the economic issues there, because it's going to become a place, if you want to be outside and you're trying to create a very large outside area, it's going to become more and more difficult as the years go by. That also would include, of course, vehicle traffic in the city in terms of how it participates in allowing that more. Obviously, sculptured lands that are covered with pavement or concrete will make the temperature higher, so that the need for less cars downtown seems to me to be really important, and if the plan will include that sort of aspect, and yet allow very quick access into the city from other people. So I guess it's directly partly to you, but it's also related to down here, because in our area, we're taking away waterfront now. We got it. We got some lovely pictures. We had one picture that showed this lovely area, but if we showed a picture of that now, it would show three other buildings that are downtown blocking the view of people, and we never had a participation in that decision. So I hope you at least will take into consideration that now you've got the land to hold on to it and not use it as a credit card for later on to gain assets. But that's the second thought, I guess, really. The main one is there some consideration about how hot it is in Ottawa or how humid it is?
Well, you're talking about the heat island effect. The heat island effect, of course, is worst where there is the most reflective surface. And, you know, and it was interesting in Houston and recently to see how, you know, some better urban planning could have relieved, I think, some of the burden of what they had. In Ottawa, the impacts of climate change are complex. In some ways, they're positive, to be honest. The season, growing season will be longer. The golf courses will be open longer. Our golf course leases will yield more revenues. But these are minor benefits compared to the very serious worries we have about it, which are invasive species, which are costing more and more of our budget. All of our ash trees are dying, and we've had to cut down 7,000 in the past 18 months. To protect the public. We have other species that are coming in. These are very serious issues for us, and they will be very costly issues, and we have to learn to adapt to them. Also, things like the Rideau Canal's gateway, major national symbol, our studies show that over the coming decades, the season will, as it has been, getting shorter and shorter and shorter until maybe it's not something we can offer to Canadians anymore. We have the largest winter cross-country skiing trail network in North America, and really, it's people come from all over the world to ski in Gatineau Park. That would be something that will be at risk as the years go on. So what I say is, winter is very precious, and it's a precious it's a commodity that will become more and more precious as time goes on. So those are some of the main aspects that I would say in terms of heat. I don't think of Ottawa as being a super hot place, but I do feel of it thinking that our beautiful winters are at risk, and to be the second coldest capital in the world used to be something that you would put it down. Now it's a precious commodity, and people will come to experience the last of these kinds of experiences if we continue on our course of warming the planet.
Do you have other questions?
Oh, thanks.
It's not really directed at anyone, but reference Catherine. I attended Catherine's lecture about the Provincial Museum, and one of the items that came out of that was the need for people to gather. And I really think that's an important element. And gathering spaces are required, and we have some. Charlottetown is fortunate I think the construction of a new band shell created another gathering space in Victoria Park, which is a nice element. There was proposed fingers to go off the boardwalk in Victoria Park that would have been other gathering places for smaller groups to gather, and I think that still could be an important element down the road. But my question is, the front lawn of the Parliament buildings is obviously a great gathering spot. The considerations of security must be paramount, I imagine, now, and I think that was evidenced in the Canada Day celebrations with the security issues of the day and during Canada Day. And so I'm wondering, how is that a hurdle we get over? And I really miss the soapbox era, not that I grew up in it, but that opportunity for people to have a public forum in a public space. And it's been taken over by the social media soapbox, which is no faces and no audience. So I'm just wondering, is that a consideration? And maybe this should have been mentioned at a meeting 10 years ago or whenever you first started your work. But I think gathering spaces are important, the need that you've mentioned, the charter, people would like to come and, or I'm not sure if it's a charter, use the example of gathering, people could come and gather to see that other than in the Supreme Court building. So the creation of more spaces like that, that people can just come and gather at, exchange ideas and whatnot in an open forum. And I think that's an important element of any plan, both in Charlottetown and Ottawa, that's all.
Can I respond? That's a great point, and I think we're all at the commission. We're all very proud of the basis of this plan in consultation, and not just consultation, but engagement. I mean, the ideas in the plan really do reflect what people thought, and it's a very different kind of plan than I think, Doug. You probably looked at it and thought it's not exactly typical of a land planner's plan, and Alex, you know. But it's the summit of a series of plans that go down, Alex, into more like comprehensive municipal plans. But one of the things we've done is over the past 3 years, we've had a capital urbanism lab where we took an empty floor in our building and made it into a pop-up ideas lab. And we have events. We had an event there, I think, is it tonight or is it last night? Last night on the socially inclusive public transportation, and we had experts from around the world talking about how public transportation can be made more accessible to people with limited economic or mobility issues or so forth. And we've talked everything about how smart vehicles and automated vehicles and are going to be coming in. We've had sessions on resiliency and stormwater management and so forth. And this has become, in the capital, probably the go-to place for these kinds of discussions. And we're full every night. We have 150 people. And so for us, this event tonight is very similar to the kind of thing we're doing pretty much every week. And there has proven to be a great public interest in this. You're absolutely right. People want to come out and discuss this. Chief Francis, we had a session in June where we worked with the Indigenous Placemaking Council, which is a group of largely Indigenous Canadian architects, and we brought in the 16 recent graduates in architecture, planning, and design from across the country to do a placemaking charrette for the capital. And it was fascinating. Many of them had never been to Ottawa or Gatineau before. And they laid out a vision that was very, very interesting. And when I hear you talk about your new waterfront center and the center at UPEI and so forth, I guess if may I ask a question?
Sure.
And sort of lead from this? I'm curious about this idea of placemaking and what your perception would be from a Mi'kmaq perspective of how Indigenous placemaking could occur here, but also in the capital.
Yep. Well, I think, placemaking in terms of us going forward, our waterfront building is going to be a good example. An example of meaningful inclusion in terms of Mi'kmaq people on Prince Edward Island. And, it can happen in various ways, but I think that's one example of how we would see it.
Who will use that facility, or who will be invited to visit that facility?
The facility is open to the public. It's open to our Indigenous people who require various programs and services, the off-reserve community as well as the on-reserve community. And also it will have retail space. It'll have cultural space. So it's just a variety of uses, but all to the benefit of not only our people, but the general public as well. So we're really quite excited about it. And it's the first time in our history that we are down in the city of Charlottetown, the center core. We feel that we're really a part of the city, in that sense, in terms of partnership and engagement. And, the mayor has supported us tremendously in that, the city council, the province, and as well as the federal government. So when you talk about meaningful inclusion, in terms of that, it's all of those.
I wonder if it ties together with some of the other points, because I know that in Ottawa we have all the diplomatic missions are based in Ottawa. So I meet with ambassadors, every week I have meetings with ambassadors about different projects and whether it's their embassy locations or public diplomacy initiatives. And I can tell you all of them are interested in the government's reconciliation agenda, and the whole theme of Indigenous tourism, of visits, it always comes up, and this may be something that your Welcome Center may touch even interest well beyond the borders here, people who would like to come and know the culture of the Mi'kmaq people.
Exactly. It's certainly a starting point, and we all know that the residential school era has done a great damage to our culture, and a lot of us are now getting that back, and we're taking bite-sized pieces in terms of relearning our culture when it comes to experiential tourism and so on. But definitely down the road, that's something that we're looking at for sure.
Dr. Christensen, one of the 17 Keystone initiatives is special consideration for one of the river islands to commemorate particularly the Aboriginal contribution to the city. You want to elaborate on that perhaps a little bit?
Yeah, This came back from Canadians as one of the top ideas across the country was to support some kind of indigenous center or activity on Victoria Island, and it really chimes with the long-term vision of Elder William Commanda, who was a very prominent leader of the Algonquin community, who passed away a few years ago at a very advanced age. And I had met him three times and heard from him his vision for Victoria Island, which is really an ambitious one, which it would be modest in one sense, but ambitious in another. Modest in the sense that it would just open up the island to visitors, but particularly to invite indigenous peoples of the world to gather in some format on Victoria Island. Now, what expression that will take or could take is really, I think, up to the Algonquins themselves, and I meet regularly with the delegation of Algonquin chiefs, and we have a committee looking at developing a master plan for Victoria Island, and we'll see where that leads. But I think there's great support for Canadians for that project, and it's really up to the Algonquins, I think, to understand how they want to act as the host First Nation of the capital region, and then find a way to express it on the island.
Marvelous. Any further questions? We have.
Can I ask one more?
You sure can.
Just off Catherine, I'm really fascinated that there was a charrette 28 years ago with the National Capital Commission here. And can you tell us just a little more about how that happened and how it was the NCC came here and what happened?
Well, I don't think you...
Use your mic.
Oh, sorry.
I think it's on.
I don't think you understand your history well enough.
I'm a historian, and I didn't know. Mea culpa.
I couldn't remember the lady's name, but it was Aileen Merriam, and we did a lot of good things together. We really, that was a very helpful workshop for us, and it brought us in connection with the planners. I can't remember all their names now. It was what year did I say it was?
28 years ago.
So yeah, it's 28 years ago.
Might have been Laurie Thornton, Laurie Thornton, or Linda DeCare.
I mean, it was. We made friends. We went to meetings, and we did it. I don't know how we did it, but it's not happening today. I know that. Well, I'm trying to find the...
Well, we'd love to do that again if there was any interest in us.
Well, I'll copy this out for you and give it to you.
Well, the important thing is that some of the items that were identified in there were acted upon, including most recently the campaign that you led to have the bells reinstalled.
That was really funny when I saw that. I mean, we've been at that for 20 years. But what year did I tell you? I can't even find it now.
Was it 88 or 86?
I think it was 80, yeah.
86?
I just can't remember. Yeah. Anyway.
Well, let's hope it doesn't have to be another 28 years.
Exactly,
anyway.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, if there are no further questions, we got all kinds. Yeah, see, all we had to do was threaten.
Yes, thank you. A question to Dr. Chris Manson and other panelists. We think of other capital cities around the world, and are there models that you particularly have in mind? Are there elements and aspects of other capital cities, national, provincial, state, North America, Europe, Asia, wherever, that have components that might be useful in the 50-year plan that is proposed? Thank you.
Well, that's a great question. I mean, I have my personal favorites in certain areas, I could tell you things I love about Paris that I'd love for us to do in Ottawa. There are elements of Canberra that the War Museum and how that's organized are beautiful. But what we learned through this process is that people travel, and you don't actually need experts on the planning department or me at the NCC to go travel and tell you what's good in the world. People travel, they see. These workshops we have in our urbanism lab are often attended by young people who travel, and they see things and they come back, and I'll sit at a table and
a group of young people had just come back from Vienna, and they said, we must have active, pedestrian, lively, business-driven streets like Vienna has. So I think in the 17 ideas, it kind of reflects some of that cosmopolitanism of Canadians. Canadians are great travelers, and they go and they see things in other places. I think Washington is a great influence. You can see that in the comments that people bring about the museums and national institutions. But I do think that that we have an opportunity to do something quite Canadian and innovative and unique. That can draw on all of these examples, but not necessarily follow them. And I think that's happening. I think, the 150th anniversary, although a lot of the resources have gone into ephemeral kind of events and celebrations, we've also done a lot of legacy things that I think will lead to a more robust cosmopolitan city in the future. And for one thing, the city of Ottawa is investing massively in a light rail system. And we're going to have transit-oriented development is already started in the capital that will transform the built form of the city. And I know you have questions here about densification and how to preserve the character and almost the colonial character that's so charming of Charlottetown. But on the other hand, you need to densify the urban core probably for all kinds of environmental, economic, social reasons, and these are very interesting questions. Now, we haven't talked about how in the capital we have a views protection regime that protects views to Parliament, and these view cones you can't build into without a lot of it's very difficult to get an exemption to do that. But basically, height is allowed everywhere else, and particularly if it's oriented to the transit, to the light rail transit that's coming in. The city is quite aggressive about allowing density. So this is going to really increase the urban core population of the capital that I think will have many, many good effects and will allow some of these wonderful things you see in other capital cities to take place. So that balancing some kind of plan for intensification with preserving the heritage character, I think, is going to be one of the big challenges here in Charlottetown. But I'm sure you'll find ways to do it successful, and that's going to be our challenge as well.
There was another question here.
Thank you very much. It's not so much a question, it's a commentary on our Dreamcatcher project that we did here this year. And I just wanted to say that this project not only involved a creative team here with Indigenous leaders across Canada and 26 children that toured the country talking about the project. And for me and for all of the people at Confederation Center of the Arts, we were completely changed by this project. And we were changed by it because of what we learned. And I think one of the most important things that happened this year wasn't just that it was Canada 150, it was because we all learned about the Truth and the Reconciliation Commission report and the calls to action. And many of us took that very much to heart. And so I would urge the nation's capital to be extremely inclusive, and that I would hope to see that Victoria Island is not just about the First Nations of that place, but of the whole entire country. And even this massive dream catcher that we have up here above us, it represents every province and territory of the country, but it doesn't necessarily include every First Nation of the country, which I would like it to. And then I will make an offer of the Indigenous leader that helped us put this all together. He wanted to take it down at the end of this year and send it to the House of Commons in Ottawa. And I said, well, you can't do that, Nick, because we have to keep it here. I said, I'll talk to someone to see if they would like to have one of their own. So there's an idea for you in terms of total inclusiveness and truly recognizing the First Nations of our country and the incredible contributions they made to it over the past 15,000 years. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. I mean, I learned about this just from the internet, and then saw it and realized how more wonderful it is. But my understanding is the project was led by a Mi'kmaq from Prince Edward Island. So in a way, it is an expression of the host First Nation community drawing in everyone else. And I think, you know, it's a great example that I'll use in Ottawa where this has been done, because I think it's a challenge. And we know that the old U.S. Embassy on Wellington Street, directly across from Parliament, which is looks like General Custer's office, to be honest, has been given to the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis leadership to use how they will, and we're all starting to work together to see how that can be achieved. But one of my themes in discussions with decision makers about this has been, well, you know, we should start with the Algonquin host First Nation and then move from there about towards this. So the Dreamcatcher is a great, you know, success story, I think, in that model. So I'll take that back with me and let people know about that.
Do we have any further questions? Don't be shy. Well, if there are no further questions, I'd like to thank everyone for their attentiveness. Particularly want to thank our panelists, Chief Brian Francis, Catherine Hennessy, Doug Keefe, and Alex Forbes, and thank as well Dr. Mark Christensen and all of the staff of the NCC for not only developing this plan, but sharing it with us here this evening. There will be an opportunity for tea and crumpets, I think, next door. And Michelle, where are you? I think they're out this way, and it will be an opportunity for you to circulate and to speak to some of the panelists, some of the board members of the NCC, or some of the employees of NCC. Again, want to thank Basil and Carol and Lisa, members of the National Capital Commission's board from the Atlantic region, for being here this evening as well. And thanks everyone for coming out and for expressing this great interest in the next 50 years in our national capital. Thanks.